is this concept?
Everybody ready?
Mm-hmm.
Where's Mr. Stone?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go ahead and bring the meeting. Mr. Willard. Okay. He'll mosey up here. We'll go ahead and bring the meeting, the August 22nd meeting of the St. Mary's County Planning Commission into order at this time. Like to welcome everybody to it. There is a sign-in sheet outside the door that you should have filled out if you are attending tonight's hearing in case any information needs to be sent to you regarding any of the cases or the case that we're having this evening. Also, there's a sign-in sheet if you are speaking. We remind you that the statements you should be kept to 5 minutes or less if at all possible. You are to direct your statements, questions, and responses to the board only, and we will direct them to the appropriate person for an answer. Public comment will remain opening if the hearing is continued in case any new information is provided by staff or the applicant. All persons testifying or asking questions during a hearing are required to take an oath. Our meetings are being recorded for the public record. Any comment made by anyone must be recorded as part of the record. Therefore, you must come up to one of the microphones provided. Your comments cannot be recorded unless they are directed to a microphone, and we thank you for your cooperation with that. At this time, I'll let the board members introduce themselves, starting with Mr. Van Kirk.
Joe Van Kirk.
Patty Robrek.
Martin Siebert.
Shelby Guazzo.
Howard Thompson.
Hal Willard.
Dan Aknowski.
Okay, also with us this evening, we have the Director and Deputy Director of Land Use and Growth Management, Mr. Phil Shire and Bill Hunt. Also with us are Susan McAuliffe and Bob Bowles. Mr. George Sparling is here for the County Attorney. Our videographer this evening is Amy Carter. And our recording secretary and keeper of everything is Ashley Renshaw. At this time, I'll see, we did have one set of minutes from the August 8th hearing. Did everybody have a chance to review those?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any deletions, corrections? I'll accept the motion to accept those.
So moved.
Second.
And I have a second by Mr. Willard. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Okay, on our agenda this evening, we have one public hearing. It's for a major subdivision at the Underwood Farm, number 16-12000001 at the Underwood Farm. The owner is John Chapelier. The agent is Little Silence Rest, and the action required is a preliminary plan approval of a 5-lot and 11 farmstead major subdivision. Also on our agenda this evening is after that will be a discussion with the board members, and the discussion is, has to do with the recommendation of the planning commission to the commissioners of St. Mary's County on the sign ordinance that we that has already had a public meeting on. There's nothing else on our agenda. We'll go ahead and begin the first evening, first case of the evening. And Ms. McAuliffe, you are doing so this evening. You're doing the first case.
I am.
At this time, I'll go ahead and get everybody sworn in. Anybody that will be making any statements this evening, coming up for questions, has anything to do with this first case, if you would raise your right hand, I'll swear you in. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Okay.
And if anybody wants to make a comment after the hearing, after they hear what happens during the case, I can go ahead and swear you in that. Okay, Ms. McAuliffe, go ahead.
Okay, so tonight we're doing the major subdivision 16-12-0001 Underwood Farm. The action requested is a preliminary plan approval for a 5-lot, 11 farmstead major subdivision. The property and hearing requests were advertised in the Enterprise on August 3rd and August 10th. The property's been posted. Certified mail receipts have been submitted for the required mailings. I supplied you with the applicable regulations from the County Comprehensive Plan, the County Zoning Ordinance, and the County Subdivision Ordinance. Background information on the project is pursuant to the Sustainable Growth and Agricultural Preservation Act of 2012. This project is grandfathered as a major subdivision with preserved perk test from permit 063207, applied for on November 13, 2006. The preliminary subdivision plan was reviewed during the May 12, 2016 TEC cycle. I've given you the seven findings the Planning Commission must make for preliminary plan approval. Staff believes this plan is in keeping with the goals and objectives of the comprehensive plan and recommends approval of the preliminary subdivision plan. I've also supplied you with a recommendation for a motion of approval should you so choose to use it. This concludes my presentation. I'll be happy to answer any questions. And also here with us tonight is Mr. Steve Vaughn from LSR representing the client. Question?
Back of sheet, of the Health Department sheet, attachment three, under comments it says, there are two little asterisks. It says GAP will have to be obtained prior to signature also. Just when you think you've seen it all, what is a GAP?
It's a GAF, and it's
GAF?
For
looks like a P.
Groundwater appropriation. Oh, it is a P?
No, P.
Groundwater appropriation permit.
Okay. That's something new?
No, sir, not that I know of.
Anybody else have any questions of staff?
Who approves the groundwater appropriation?
Health Department.
Okay. How does it, what's the criteria for that?
I can research it for you, sir, but I don't know the answer to that question. I'd have to ask the health department what their criteria is.
That gives them permission to have to drill a well, right?
Yes, sir.
Can you look into that? I mean, I have, you want to make any comment on it?
If they just say well.
Sure.
I can't say that I know much more about it, but it's MDE, Maryland Department of the Environment. It's their permit for a well. They've always had them ever since I've been here. Anytime you drill a well, you need a permit from the state for that.
And they just didn't get that at this time?
Apparently. Okay.
I mean, there isn't, I guess, I don't know what Mr. Seaver's thinking, but I'm thinking, was there a problem with the water up there, not enough water or anything like that?
Nothing apparent in the file that I remember, so.
No, I wouldn't think of that at all. I just wasn't familiar with the term GAP have to be approved. I guess, is that something that typically the well driller gets? I mean, is that?
I would imagine, yes.
Had a lot of wells drilled and never remember having to do that. It's not something new, so somebody's doing it.
Well, well driller has to be licensed, so I would imagine that the licensed professional does have to be the one to get the permit.
Okay.
I had a well that went bad, and I had to get a new well drilled, but I don't remember having to get a permit to do that.
I'll look into that tomorrow morning.
Thanks.
Just kidding.
Thank you.
Sure,
because you're next in line anyway, Mr. Hunt, so if you can give us a little insight on it.
Hopefully a little bit more. The groundwater appropriations permit is not necessarily a permit for a well. That is obtained through the building permit process. The groundwater appropriation permit allocates the lots or gives the lots the ability to drill wells. So basically, it's just allocating for the subdivision itself. They're controlling their access points, their drill access points to the aquifers, and it's their tracking method to make sure that we don't get too many taps into the aquifer. It's just a tracking mechanism, and it's a standard operating procedure for every major subdivision that we do. Why they put that note on here, I don't know, because it is a part. I think it was put on there strictly as a reminder that this needs to happen.
Okay.
Thank you.
And this is something that's done with major subdivisions?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions, comments for staff? You sat down for nothing. Come on back up here.
For the record, my name is Wayne Hunt, land surveyor with Little Silences Rest, here on behalf of the client tonight who cannot be here. They are out of state, so they will not be available for questions. In addition to myself here, I also have my associate Steve Vaughn. He'll be running the slide projector, but he is also the person who signed the plats. He is going to be a little bit more intimately knowledgeable about what's going on with them. As most of you know, Bill Higgs started the company that I work for. I'm taking over for him, which is why you're seeing more of me. That's next in line. You'll be seeing more of him later. Underwood Farms, major subdivision. I'm going to be a little disjointed here tonight in my presentation. I apologize. I was telling everybody else. I got into a fight with PowerPoint on my way over here and lost, so I haven't been as prepared as I would like to be. I'm going to be doing individual slide types of presentations. Some of the things that I would like to walk you through here. First off is just this overview here to give you an idea of where the property is located. It is off of Mount Wolf Road, you see there in the middle of the project. It's behind, we're in close proximity to the Charlotte Hall Town Center, which is on the left of your screen that you see there. In the left middle of the screen would be the Wawa and Food Lion, all those stores right there, that complex. So we're sharing the same road there that is at that intersection with the Wawa, the Rite Aid, and the Food Lion once again. Go ahead and move to the next one. Zooming in a little bit closer here, you can see that a majority of the property is forested. There is some agricultural use of the property. Let's see. What I wanted to show you next was just an overlay with the proposed development. You can see that we're utilizing quite a bit of the open area in what we're doing. There's some cluster requirements for the subdivision in an RPD, and this is how we're obtaining it. It may not be clustered in, but at the same time, we're taking advantage of the areas that would be least impact to the woods and the environment. And I'm going to show you how we came about this with a few more slides. First off, this light blue that I've added to the plan are the highly erodible soil types. There are some areas where we are into the highly erodible soil types in the bottom that you'll see there, but the majority of the rest of the development takes place outside of those areas. The roadways that are coming in to access this site are on top of existing gravel roadbeds. There will be improvements made to them so that they will meet county standards, but a majority of the roadbeds there, so we don't have to do clearing or much clearing to make them comply with regulations inside of those highly erodible soils.
Good.
Next one. Now on top of that, I've just added steep slopes. The dark blue are the 25% steep slopes and highly erodible soils, and those are the ones to really stay away from, which we have done with the development. And go ahead on to the next one. And finally, we show you the expanded wetland buffers or stream buffers on top of that. We've stayed totally outside of them, once again, except for the road that goes through them at the top there that you see. And of course, once again, that's over an existing roadbed, so we have minimized our impact to that buffer. Other items, I mean, I guess I'd like to go over the staff analysis real quick and just talk about, you know, sufficient access points for the property to start with. We have two access points. We chose to access the property from two points like this because of the way that the land lies. It's got two fingers that stretch out. It's got two areas for development, and they're separated by a stream, and it's associated buffers and also the slopes. And to have one access point and tee off would be to probably disturb areas that would be better off left alone. The reason, obviously, for doing the five lots and the farmsteads was so that we could utilize a private drive road section all the way through. Having that long, winding road going down the right side of the project would be very costly as a major or as a public roadway section. We're allowed to do a private road section like this. It's less impact to the environment, and also helps make, you know, it shouldn't be a consideration, but it's a cost thing for our client. If it were to be a public road, it would probably drive this project to the point of not being financially feasible. Public facilities are adequate. This is served by Mount Wolf Road, and I do know that on a Saturday morning, living in Mechanicsville myself, that the intersection there with Mount Wolf Road and Triangle Drive can get a little congested, but I don't believe it's anything that's above and beyond elsewhere you might find in the county. Once again, the reports and the traffic counts show that it is operating at an acceptable level of service, even with the addition of the 17 users. We are not providing access to adjoining parcels of land, as the disturbances would create more problems than they would solve. We will meet stormwater management. We have filed a plan with the Department of Public Works and received preliminary approval of the concept stormwater management plan for this development. So we are able to install these roads and also the required environmental site design facilities that go along with it within the areas that I showed you previously in yellow, the areas that we plan to disturb for this development. In addition, we will be, of course, addressing all of the sediment erosion control requirements, especially considering we are in the proximity of steep slopes. DPW and Soil Conservation District will direct our design as we move forward, ensuring that any points of discharge are adequately controlled from the top of the slope down to the stream channel to help prevent erosion on these highly erodible soils in this area. All the highly erodible soils in the Patuxent River watershed are, of course, sensitive. Staff has recommended us to be exempt from providing recreational amenities. Of course, that is up to you if you feel as though something else needs to be provided. They say a walking path or a bicycle trail, something to that effect, and I don't believe that the owners would be adversely objective to a walking path of some kind if you deem it necessary for this.
Can I ask, where's the common ground to have this at? It looks like they're all farmsteads, right?
Everything is taken up in farmsteads, yes.
So you're exempt from all that? I mean, we can't order a road, a trail through there to cross people's property.
I've seen it done with easements before, but yes, I would prefer not to do it.
I mean, how would you ever sell the...
Exactly. Thank you.
On the entryway itself, would you provide a wide enough shoulder for people to walk?
Acceleration, deceleration lanes will be required as part of this. Yes, full axle decel.
I mean, inside the development itself, instead of having... How wide would the line down the side of your road, how much shoulder would you provide? Would you provide enough, say, to have a baby carriage go down the side of that road type of a thing?
It's going to be required to have a 4-foot shoulder on either side. And it's a grassed shoulder, not a gravel shoulder. So it's going to be an 18-foot wide road section with a gravel shoulder or a grass shoulder.
Great.
It could be made gravel. And I don't think that's going to be a huge ordeal. I mean, typically like to have the grass road section just to provide some dampening or some slowing down of the water before it gets into the ditch section. But I don't believe with the environmental site design, the way it's being done today, that's as much of an issue as it used to be. So, yes, we could do that if you deemed it necessary.
The board can discuss that as we get into it, if it leans toward approval, see if they want to do anything like that.
How long is that longer road? I can't figure it out here. How many feet?
Okay. 600 feet for the short one. What about 2,600 feet.
Is that half a mile?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Question. The plan indicates that there's going to be a 20-foot pedestrian equestrian easement. Is there any work to be done in that, or that's just going to be reserved across the property?
Just a trail for horse riding.
Trail for horse riding.
Will the trail be constructed or left for others to do it? Or
left for others to do.
Okay. And another question. Could you clarify how much of the road you're going to be building? And the reason I ask that is because note 14 indicates that the access easement does not necessarily provide access from these lots to a county or state road at this time. Road and utility construction and maintenance are the responsibility of the buyers of these lots, unless otherwise provided herein. But you're saying now that you will construct that road, and obviously they'll be responsible for maintenance. Is that correct?
The road will be constructed or bonded.
Okay.
Now, the way that this is probably going to work out, I'm going to be honest with you, is that they're going to try and drag this out for a while until the market rebounds a little bit to sell these lots. So they're going to, you know, wait until the last possible moment to record the lots, at which point in time the lots will be recorded, but they won't necessarily have the roadway put in. It'll be bonded for installation.
The entire roadway or just the entrance?
The entire roadway. Now, it's going to be very difficult and not very marketable to sell lots without access. So it's in their best interest to have the road installed before they even begin to think about selling lots.
And those roads are going to be turned over to the county?
No, those are private.
Again, you're exempt from all that because these are farmsteads.
Mm-hmm.
So your property line goes right down the middle of the road. And at the point at which you've sold the last lot, you will vacate, and it becomes the property of all of the folks who have bought the lot.
Yes, there will be a road maintenance agreement.
Yes.
Put in place.
Ma'am, quick question.
Sure.
What was the, other than you said there was a stream in between John Augustus Lane and Underwood Farmway and some wooded areas? It didn't look very hilly or sloped. Was there any proposal to actually connect them with a boundary from John Augustus across the front of the property? So, I mean, virtually you have three access points out of here. Is that correct?
No, we have two at this point. Two access points?
The note says that Farmstead 14 has direct access.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The
yeah,
road.
One private drop. One will have direct access.
So there's actually three. What was the main reason why a connector road wasn't put between John Augustus and Underwood Farmways? Was it the cost? Was it because there was a stream there? I didn't.
Probably cost, if I was to hazard a guess. That, and it looks like marketability. Because you'll have a lot that's right there at the front, and the easiest way to get to the private drive would be to go through that lot up front. So it just made more sense to take it towards the road.
And to touch on one of the other questions, does not going to have sidewalks along each section of the road?
No, sir.
And that's because they're farmsteads?
Correct.
I would be in favor of, if they're not going to have sidewalks, either have a wider strip of blacktop or some sort of side on the road.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are going, it's a half mile road. We're not providing any sort of recreational spots or anything in there. So,
but how much trouble are you going to have doing that with stormwater? I mean, don't they want grass? They want that surface filtration right up to the sides of the road. Typically,
but you see, once again, we're using environmental site design here, and the slopes are such that we can't utilize that credit. It's a different kind of credit. It's a grass channel credit. And through the majority of what we're doing here, we're actually channelizing it to microbial retention devices.
Okay.
So the way that we've attacked this,
you'll be able to do that.
We'll be able to do it.
How many of those ditches are they requiring you to have with the full of gravel? Is that what it is, the gravel ditches beside the road?
Actually, it's going to be...
drains too.
We're still too steep for those too. You need to be relatively flat to use those.
Oh.
We're using rectangular devices parallel to the road, typically at the low points. You know, try and get all the water to the low points, treat it at that point, and then discharge it.
Okay.
And in doing so, we've got grass channels that run along the edge of the roads that are controlling all of that runoff. So it's really not that big of a deal for us. We just have to increase the size a little bit for the additional impervious area.
Okay.
How come it's only a 40-foot right-of-way for a half-mile road?
I believe all that's required is 22 feet, so we have expanded it.
Yeah, the length doesn't have anything to do with what the right-of-way that's required. It could be 2 miles long if it feeds.
Thank you, Martin.
Yeah.
You feel comfortable there's no, there won't be any impact to Crooked Creek Lane? That's your driveway that's backing right up to, say, lots 3, lots 4, coming on down.
First off, when you say won't affect Crooked Creek Lane, what are you looking for specifically, please?
I guess I'm just for the protection of the neighbors that are back there at off that lane. I mean, there's you just talked about some significant stormwater management that y'all are going to provide on your road.
Mm-hmm.
That's not going to, you know, the water's going to go somewhere. It's not going to impact the neighbors that are behind these lots, impact their road, anything like that. Just want to make sure that they're protected back there.
They are protected in that we are going to provide environmental site design for those lots. Their drainage does go towards Craney Creek, I believe that is, or Crooked Creek Road, but they will be controlled. So yes, there is some development that will be directed towards their road, but it will be controlled.
That's what I was looking for. I want to make sure that those neighbors know that, you know, they feel comfortable that if something is coming out in front of them, that it's not going to impact. We've had cases come before us not too long ago where the development part of it was impacting their roads, and it was things were going back and forth on it. I just want to make sure that it's stated right out that you're comfortable, very comfortable, that that's not going to impact their road or anything on their side of the world.
We have no exemptions for stormwater management. Everything is required to meet environmental site design standards.
Okay. I just like happy neighbors. So are you, I'm sure.
Will this road be put in before you sell these lots?
I would like to say so, but I am not the owner. I cannot guarantee that.
Half a mile of road up and down these little hills that this crosses is very difficult to keep up, because I do that for our family. This is 11 separate families you've got on here. A little gravel road is very hard to keep up with traffic on it. And
I don't know what to say other
than get some people coming down from the city to buy these wonderful lots that they can't use because it's got trees all over it anyway. And now they have to pay several hundred dollars a year to, first of all, you got to find somebody that'll grade the road. And that's pretty difficult. Mm-hmm. And then you got to grade it and keep it up. Potholes and all that stuff. There's a lot of, if you don't build that road, I'm in favor of let the buyer beware, but this is almost too much.
Well, wouldn't it be fair to say that the current owner so chooses to sell it as is? I mean, he could get the approval and someone could just come along and say, I want to buy that place. So it could certainly be sold before the road is built.
Which is the reason for some of the notes in here, to make people aware of that
but
fact or
certainly
that potential.
No one's going to build a house there before the road is built.
No.
I mean, obviously. So. One comment on yours. Asking the question.
Okay.
Mr. Sparling, we have all sorts of things in people's deeds about farms next door and so forth.
I would request, go ahead.
I think it is something that maybe should be in the deed clearly, that there will be a road maintenance agreement to keep up a gravel road with the 11 lots on it or something.
Well, first of all, keep in mind what a road maintenance agreement is. It's okay. A private contract, which you're going to have now with the 16 lots. Is that what I'm looking at? Mm-hmm. It's going to be a private contract between 16 different people. The enforceability of that contract becomes a very difficult issue. Mm-hmm. If people stop paying or contributing, then who's got the onus of going forward and collecting that money? I'm not just, you know, taking a position or attempting to sway you, but I would ask that if you're going to approve this plan, that you make it a condition that my office approve this road maintenance agreement. I think this is a very legally difficult situation.
And we've had situations, people come in here that have had significant issues with those road maintenance agreements.
I would welcome that extra layer of review.
In all honesty, we all know that road maintenance agreements are typically not worth the paper they're written on. They pacify a mortgage company.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And if we both share a road, and I have a four-wheel drive F-350 all jacked up with big tires, and you have a Mercedes 550 SE, we're not ever going to agree when that road needs to be repaired. So, you got to do a road maintenance agreement. I thought we had a standard, but I thought that the county had pretty standard form for them.
We do have a standard, yes. I wouldn't argue with Mr. Sparling in that it may be insufficient to protect all of the people who are in that agreement. It's just a boilerplate.
You know, on the other hand, these are, by their nature, they are farmsteads. They're exempt from a lot of this stuff, the only way to really enforce it would be a homeowners association. And if the folks that buy it all choose to not have that, then they're not going to have it.
I would certainly separate the two lanes. I wouldn't ask the people that are only four on a little short piece of road to be part of the long half-mile road over there on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And then 14 doesn't have to be in it at all.
We typically write them per road or per access.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you cleared that up.
But it sounds like we need to have that road built up to standards to alleviate a lot of these problems that it sounds like it's going to be. To me, that would make it easier for the owner, though the cost beforehand is going to be more for him. I think it would be easier for them to sell those farmsteads with a proper road going back through there.
When you say cost up to standard, you're saying a county road constructed all the way back?
That's the whole purpose of doing them in farmsteads, so you're exempt from that.
Yeah, but we're talking about a lot of problems here. Even the applicant said, you know, it could be a lot of problems with road maintenance agreements.
That's the seller's problem. You can't require something that's not required.
I didn't say it was required. I said it might be a suggestion to the developer that they do that to help them sell. I mean, that would be a much easier sell in my book if I knew there was a proper road to get back to lot number. If I wanted to, well, I want to get all the way back as far as I can away from the road, I want to go back to number 7. But I surely wouldn't want a gravel road that I don't know who's going to take care of it. And as he said, there's a lot of ifs, ands, maybes, and buts that come with that. If I'm going to put out all that money, you know, I mean, and I have no idea how much money I'm talking about at this time, but I mean, if I want to build myself a nice house on a farmstead at the end of a half-mile road, half-mile driveway, so I don't have to tell you, that's a pretty good-sized, pretty lengthy driveway. And you just said if you're there on your F-350, you can get in and out, buddy, on lot number 9, but I might be in my, whatever you said, Mercedes on farmstead number 7. I might not be able to get in and out too well. So it's just, that's just an observation. Everybody can make their own observation.
High aspect.
Like I say, it's not a requirement, but it's a darn good selling point for the developer itself. So just an observation. Any other questions, Mr. Hunt? Mr. Hunt, anything else you want to put out there?
No, I'm sure there'll be other opportunities this evening.
Anybody else has any other questions?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, at this time, I'll open it up.
I just had one question for Mr. Bowles. Are there any limits on people, as many entrances on, is it more than 7 on a private road? I can't recall. If you would refresh my memory, I'd appreciate it.
I didn't catch your question.
Is it written down someplace how many entrances, how many dwelling units can be on a private road before you have to?
You can have up to 7 lots.
Uh-huh.
Or any number of farmsteads.
Any number of farmsteads. Yes. Okay. So this is kind of a hodgepodge. Okay.
No combination type formula or anything like that.
Well, you can still have, as long as you don't have over 7 lots
okay.
on that same road. And farmsteads are 15 acres or more, so.
Bob, is there a construction standard for the private road in either the road subdivision regulations or zoning ordinance?
The private roads standards are typically 22-foot with 18-foot travelway. 22-foot easement with an 18-foot travelway. That's a private road.
Any surface requirements or is it just gravel?
Could be gravel, could be asphalt, you know, could be tar.
Okay, thank you.
Chip.
Probably could put
questions?
Millings on it if they have a steep slope.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Slow down the water.
At this time, I'll open it up to public testimony. Nobody did raise their hands, but if there's questions that have come up in that time, I'll open it up to public testimony at this time. If anybody has any questions, they can come up, and I'll swear you in at this time. Okay. Seeing none, then I'll close it. The public testimony part and open it back up to the board for discussion and questions. One thing I did forget to ask you, Mr. Hunt, the Mount Wolf intersection in the 235, I didn't see anything in the packet, but I mean that intersection is still okay as far as with the state.
I'm not sure. I mean, when we did this, the road itself operated at a acceptable level of service. I do not have any data specifically on the Route 5 and Mount Wolf Road intersection that I can, I mean, other than living there and witnessing it, that's all I've got. I don't have any hard data to give you.
There's a lot of turn lanes as it goes into 5.
Mm-hmm. And Ms. Guazzo is right. If there are steep slopes on the roadway, if they, I believe it's over 10 or 12%, they will be required to have millings, at least on more stable top coating.
Okay.
I know more than I want to know about roads, gravel roads.
Mr. Sparling, is there anything else you can give us or make us feel any better about this road maintenance agreement? I mean, you heard what I said during the hearing, where my comfort level is at. I know I can't require that, but how comfortable are you with this rather lengthy piece of road with a road maintenance agreement and say with your anything you've dealt with in the past, how good are road maintenance agreements?
Not very.
Probably not what Mr. Hunt wanted to hear.
I think Mr. Siebert's assessment probably is not far off the mark. My concern is this. Yes, buyer beware, but it's been a while since I did a residential real estate settlement, but typically people who are buying a lot get to settlement. They are concerned with their mortgage. They're flooded with papers. I don't recall many occasions on which a buyer sits and reads the notes on the plat. Now, perhaps some settlement agents make sure that their buyers do sit and read those notes on the plat. But I just looked at the plat, and number one, somebody did ask the question, the only thing that's on the plat really is that they will bond the driveway entrances. Now, Mr. Hunt says they're going to bond the road, that's fine, but as I've told you, you know, on a number of occasions, if it's not in writing, don't count on it. So I think perhaps some amendment or additional note on the plat would be appropriate, unless I missed something. I was looking very quickly. I when I asked that we be permitted in my office to approve the road maintenance agreement, no. I don't think the standard county form, which really isn't worth the paper that it's written on, and Mr. Siebert's exactly right, it's really designed to get some mortgage lender to approve a mortgage loan. It does virtually nothing to protect the ultimate consumer, the buyers of the lots. I would like to have the opportunity to craft a reasonable agreement to do the best we can to protect the consumers. I did inquire of Mr. Shire, as you saw me walk up and talk to him a couple of times, and my understanding is yes, you can have any number of farmsteads on a private road. And that is the law, and that's the ordinance that's in effect at this time. On the other hand, if you've got 16 different owners, as I described it, it's a difficult situation. And even with regard to forming a homeowners association, it's very easy to form one. It's very difficult to keep one operating. People quickly lose interest in devoting their time and attention to managing an association. Why I'm particularly interested, or of course, concerned, is this goes back to the historic reason why we generally require public roads is because sooner or later, when that road doesn't get repaired, and there are potholes, and the Mercedes cannot get back across the lane, people will start complaining to the county. My office has had the occasion on a number of times to be confronted by lot owners who are in conflict over the maintenance of a private road. And I would say most of the time we're talking four or five lots, because that used to be the typical situation when a minor subdivision was limited to five lots. Of course, now it's gone to seven because of the septic bill. And here we have, in effect, 16 lots. So if conflict arises between four owners, I think exponentially you have the potential with 16 owners. Not, and again, that's what the law is. And Mr. Hunt's client is apparently in compliance with the law. But this is an agreement that probably should be carefully crafted. I don't know whether that gives you any comfort or not, Mr. Thompson.
Well, it gives me the point to ask Mr. Hunt, would you feel comfortable with us coming up with a road maintenance agreement if this was to go forward? I mean, even before we even vote on it, to have something crafted for you, continue it, come back, let you look at it, let your applicant look at it, the owner. I'm going to let the board discuss that. I'm not here to make...
Keep in mind that we are under a deadline issue as well to get this approved. And I'm not sure if we can go for more than one continuance at this point, if any at all. I'm not sure what our deadline is for this.
Well, let's open... I like the board. I like everybody's opinion on this. I always look at Mr. Van Kirk. Tonight I'm going to look down this way and we'll work.
I think there's three issues here. One is the construction of the entrances onto the county road. Those will be bonded and approved and built in accordance with county standards, and that bond won't be released until those entrances are done satisfactorily. The second thing is the maintenance of the road. And I think we ought to ask George to go ahead and look at that what the applicant draws up, to make sure that it is fairly reasonable to enforce by a court with the property owners. And I think that's about as far as we ought to go with that part of it. The third item, which concerns me, is to guarantee the construction of the road to the standards that are in place at this time.
Which aren't much, by the way.
Pardon me?
They're not much.
Which they're not much. I agree with that. They're not much. But how do we enforce that? I think if I remember correctly, there is an allowance or a possibility where that work can be bonded and that bond enforced by land use and growth management. As a rule, that is something that they don't do in the course of normal activities, if I'm not mistaken.
Jump in. The plat will not be recorded until the road is bonded, not just the entrances.
Bonded with you all? Because
no, it'll be through Public Works construction.
Now, would Public Works bond a private road?
I'm sorry?
Will Public Works bond a private road?
I'm sure they have in the past. I can't think of any examples right now.
Well, if they will do that, I think then that's needed before the roads, before the plat's recorded, as you said. And if they're going to take that bond and honor that, that's good. That's fine. I think you're going to find they won't do a private road, though, unless something's changed.
Yeah, Mr. Hunt could probably answer better, but at least it would be under a grading permit, the bond would be.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Yes, that is the clarification that needs to be made at this point, and I need to clarify what I stated earlier as far as the road being bonded. It's a grading permit. It is not a bond for construction. It is basically, if at any point in time during the middle of construction they decide to bail out, there's enough money left in the bond to stabilize everything and bring it back, not necessarily ensure the construction of the entire road.
That's correct.
Mr. Sparling, is that something we should have the county answer for us?
Well, there's two issues. Mr. Gnasky probably knows the answer to this question better than I do, but there may be, I would like to see if there are not standards for construction of a private road in our current road ordinance.
No.
If there are not, then I think, then it would be Katie bar the door. Absolutely nothing to...
I think there's a standard in either the subdivision regulations and or the zoning ordinance, not in the road ordinance.
Well... If it's just simply width, that may or may not be the total answer, because typically whether or not you're going to have a... I'm getting out of my field, but obviously there's a lot more that goes into the construction of a road than the mere width of it. Even an unpaved road. I think that the Planning Commission ought to consider looking for some specifications as to how that road's going to be constructed. I think the Planning Commission ought to, well, I've heard two different things. First, I heard that the road was going to be bonded, but basically, no, it's not going to be bonded, so that there's no guarantee that the road will be constructed at all. So thirdly, again, I would emphasize that right now there is nothing on the plat, unless I've read it too quickly, that indicates a guarantee that the road will be constructed. So I think that some note needs to be added to the plat, because once again, if you prove the plat as it is now, there's no obligation at all. So I think if the Planning Commission is interested in any specifications for the road, any guarantee that the road's going to be built, and any notice to the potential buyers of the nature of this road, then I think those three things ought to be addressed before the plat's approved.
Good evening, Mr. Shire.
Yeah, I may make myself comfortable here.
Yeah, that's not a good sign, Mr. Shire.
These two roads that they are building along, I think they are existing.
Yes. Not entirely, but
if this was a piece of property with no roads on it and they had to build a private road, whether it was for 11 farmsteads or 7 regular lots or whatever, from scratch, Public Works would review the construction drawings. It would be designed to public road standards, basically, minus the asphalt. And Mr. Hunt, stop me if I'm off base here. We've recently had another one like that that we haven't recorded the plat yet, but Public Works approved the construction designs and the engineering for these new private roads. Our ordinance, our zoning ordinance, allows the fact that if you have an existing private road, it may serve up to 7 lots and or any number of farmsteads. So that's kind of the catch in this particular case. You have a good solid base, 2 existing roads. I would imagine that some improvement, well, we do need that 18-foot travel width and then 2 shoulders on each side, and then, of course, drainage ditches beyond that. And those standards are in our zoning ordinance. They're not diagrammed out or anything like that, but they are specified.
Mr. Hunt, how much of the Underwood Farms Way Road is there now?
Less than half.
Quarter of it? Half of it?
Well, he's looking that up. It's my understanding in the subdivision ordinance that your road standards for private drive are fairly limited. They give radius requirements, minimum radius requirements, and depth of gravel required, basically, and also the minimum, of course, width and shoulder requirements. It's there's not much there.
Mr. Shire, if I...
Wait, I want to get this question answered. About half of the road is there now?
Yes. So
about half?
Less than half.
So around 1,200 feet then?
If I match your picture to your plat, it's less, a little bit less than half.
1,200 feet.
Yeah.
The picture may not reflect all the roadway that's there. I mean, this is a farm road. They usually just go back to the residents when they do the Google Earth.
Okay.
Jumping jacks. So, Mr. Shire, the magic question is, what part of this project, is, if any, is outside the parameters of what they can do? Is there anything they're doing here that is that they're asking for some sort of exemption or non-conforming? Anything this project that's not conforming with the current rules and regulations and ordinances that we have in place now?
No, I would say that it does, in fact, conform to what the zoning ordinance allows.
I was going to guess and say zero, but yeah. Okay, so they're... Okay. So are we going to continue with the poll around...
First 13.
Oh, we're going what?
We got the one guy. You said you were going to poll us all. We got the one guy.
I'm waiting. All our questions were answered.
I'm good.
It's Mr. Willett's turn.
Yeah. I don't have anything right now.
Ms. Wilder?
I wanted to ask Mr. Hunt or make a suggestion. I doubt if any school buses will be coming down this road at all. They don't come down unpaved roads. So I think
I don't believe it's designed for school buses.
No, it's not. It's not paved. But I would suggest if you want to make this an attractive project, you widen that entrance. Unless you're going to sell this to all retired people.
What difference does it make if you're retired or not?
Not unless you have to bring up the grandchildren. That's fine.
Oh, okay.
No, I just, you know, that would be something, an amenity. These are, as Mr. Sebo has pointed out, it meets the existing rules. It just, we can see problems ahead for the people that buy this, particularly on the half-mile road that goes up and downhill. I don't know if you can say in a deed, can you reference in a deed, Mr. Sparling, I'm sorry, can you reference in a deed that the homeowner will be responsible for a road maintenance agreement or something, just to clue them in?
You can write anything you want. It's enforcing the writing that becomes the practical part.
No, I'm just trying to make the buyer beware with a few well-chosen, you know, like, there will be responsibility for a road maintenance agreement. That's all.
Correct.
Instead of having it be a surprise after the first hurricane.
Well, correct. But keep in mind, the buyer is not going to see the deed until the buyer is sitting at the settlement table. And I do want to emphasize that Mr. Siever is right. I'm not trying to encourage the Planning Commission to not apply the law as it's written, whether or not the law happens to be a good idea. What I do think, though, is that the Planning Commission does have the discretion to make sure that buyers know what they're buying into. And that's not to say that if this is a logging road, there might not be 16 people who are perfectly happy to buy a lot on a logging road. Some people may think it's a great idea, encourages privacy. I don't know. The only thing that I'm stating is I don't want the Planning Commission to leave here tonight having taken an action and be under any misunderstanding as to what the legal rights and obligations of everybody involved are. Does that help?
Should there be a note on the plat? Can we request a note be put on the plat? I don't think there's one right
now. In huge calligraphy.
But, I mean, you're our legal beagle. Can we say, as part of a resolution,
absolutely,
that a note on the plat should
absolutely
reference a homeowner's, not a homeowner, but a road maintenance agreement for each lot and or farmstead?
Certainly.
Okay. Thank you.
And I'm coming right to you.
I would also suggest that the note include the words, "Don't call the county."
can you actually say we'd like note number one to be?
Yes.
So I mean, you
all approve the plat.
You have general notes. I wouldn't want it to be note number 29, you know, or 30, if we said, you know, have it within the first 10 notes of a. Guess we can't tell them that note number one, because note number one has certain informations on them, you know, the first 4, 5, 6. But
yeah,
you see where I'm coming
and,
from.
And I don't want to imply that I've gotten any sense that Mr. Hunt's client isn't going to do exactly what Mr. Hunt is represented.
Before you run away, Mr. Sparling, can I ask this one quick question? If you're willing to look at and approve a road maintenance agreement. In the interest of this gentleman's client's, Mr. Applicant's time, how about if you simply write what you want to say?
Thank you, Mr. Siebert.
I mean, would you be willing to do that? I mean, is that...
When I said thank you, it was just I'm glad to...
No, I totally understand.
Can I confer with Mr. Hunt for a moment?
The same old kind of crap over here. No, that's disapproved. Here, no, that's disapproved. I mean, you do it.
It's a lot of nodding going on over there.
One of the problem children is Wicomico Shores. Mm-hmm. Those roads were not built.
Yeah, well, let's don't use that as an example.
They were supposed to be.
Yeah.
But they weren't built well. The drainage on them is a major problem.
Yes, sir.
The county has to keep going back.
I will be glad to draft a new road maintenance agreement for use in private roads, and that Mr. Hunt's project can be the initial signatory or user of that agreement.
Can we see that? Can you send that to us also so that we can see it?
Yes, I can.
For our future use also.
Yes, I can.
That's a nice room.
I'd still like to see the plat.
Yeah.
There will be a road maintenance agreement.
Martin, were you done?
No, actually, the only thing, here's what I have to say about the whole thing.
Yeah.
We are not,
pretty bullish.
Mm-hmm. It's not our job as a planning commission to try and protect consumers above and beyond what's required by the county per se. By the same sense, we're also not here to get in the middle of business decisions between Mr. Seller and Mr. Potential Buyer. I mean, if you for most people, the purchase of a residential, of their residence, is probably the most money they will ever spend in their life. I mean, I think that's probably a pretty fair statement. Anyone who goes and looks at a place and you know, that road or how what's going to happen to that road in the future, if that's not on their mind, you know, I'm not sure we can protect somebody like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not sure they can be protected. They're going to move in. They're going to get mad at the road or the way things are going. They're going to sell it. That's not our deal. It's not our problem. I mean, that's between the buyer and the seller, and that's not for us to, I don't believe that's for us to try to get in the middle of. I just don't think that's something it's not our job.
Well, it might not be our job, but in my opinion, it's our duty to look out for everybody. I mean, that's why we're...
Well, then you probably ought to go ahead and advertise that you're going to start up a road maintenance agreement school and a buyer's, you know, and have people sign up and go through your course, and
well,
you can teach them how to buy a house.
We're not,
but that's not what the Planning Commission does.
Well,
that's an opinion. I mean, Planning Commission doesn't have a set of rules that say what we can and cannot do.
No.
But we're here to look out for the...
Mr. Starling has a piece of property he wants to sell that has a... that does not have an asphalt road, and I want to buy it. I don't need you to tell me.
Martin, easy.
Right?
And that's why I want to emphasize that I was not at all suggesting what the role of the Planning Commission is. I was just saying from the discussion, if the Planning Commission, by majority, has certain expectations, I just want to make sure that they are clear. And with regard to the... statement that we'll redraft the road maintenance agreement. Quite frankly, I think actually Mr. Hunt just suggested that. And if it's any comfort, this has been a topic of Mr. Shire and Mr. Bill Hunt and my deputy and I meet weekly every Wednesday morning, as some of you now know. And this question of road maintenance agreements and private roads has been a topic of discussion and is on our agenda. Long before I ever saw this plat, we have discussed that there are problems with the regulations of road maintenance agreements and with regard to private roads. And insofar as the proper balance here, Planning Commission isn't a consumer protection agency, but at the same time, one of your criteria, and I know this is exactly true since there's been considerable debate about it with regard to the site plan approval, but when you approve something, to make sure that it is consistent with the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of the county. And there's a balance to be drawn there. Right. Of course, the balance is supposedly in our law, the ordinances and regulations. So I don't know whether that assists your deliberations on this or not. But I will be more than happy. This may be the impetus to go ahead and get that agenda moved, item moved to the top of our agenda.
I agree that we can't, I mean, the rules are the rules. And there's nothing that we can say or argue in regards to the approval of this because we can't reject it because they are abiding by all the rules and regulations of this document. What I think we should do is ensure that whomever buys these lots understands what it means in regards to the road and the maintenance. So therefore, I think it's important that we somehow ensure that it's put on this plat, number one. Mm-hmm. And number two, ensure that the owner does prepare and ensure that it's in the deed or whatever process that it would have to go through. That the owner understands that they are liable. Are they liable, Mr. Spaulding? Is there some way to make them liable? Because we've had other owners come in here and say, half the people don't pay it, and there's nothing we can do about it. I mean, that's really the issue, is the fact that...
I don't think we can impose the county, when I say we, I don't think the county can impose a liability on or an obligation on the developer that's not provided for in the law being our ordinances. So this appears to be a situation if the developer only intends to bond the entrances and Mr. Shire believes, and I will defer to Mr. Shire on this, that that's in compliance with the subdivision ordinance, that's the legal obligation of the developer. If there should be greater protections, then the problem lies with the ordinance, not the developer. The owner, the developer will be liable to the people who buy these lots for any breach of any promise the developer makes to those buyers.
But we're not talking about the developer. I mean, I'm going to assume that the developer is going to put the road in.
And that's
I shouldn't assume that? Well, then we should make that mandatory.
Well, I'm sorry, listening to Mr. Shire and Mr. Bowles, my understanding was that there were at least those basic specifications that had to be complied with.
I thought that's what you said, too.
We won't record a plat without proper access. And that note that Mr. Hunt read about this road does not necessarily provide access to a public. That note is 40 years old. We should do away with that note. I mean, it's just outlived its time. It tells people like, hey, there might not even be a road here, and we want to make sure that there is a road there. You know, private roads, I've dealt with a lot of them, and a fair amount end up in court as, you know, usually a drainage dispute, owner A will clog up a pipe, B because water's backing up on their land, and when they do that, then it backs up on the neighbors and so on and so forth. So these are going to end up in court, and that's where a carefully worded road maintenance agreement will at least facilitate a court judgment, you know, and that, if nothing more than that. So, I mean, these are going to end up as a civil case because they are private roads. Some people really love private roads, less government intervention, so. But they all have to solve their issues somehow, and it's either through the government, through us on the public roads, or through the court system on private roads.
So, in the final analysis, I think it is our responsibility to make sure that we do everything from a Planning Commission perspective that we can to ensure that the proper identification of possible issues is reflected, either be it on the plat, in the maintenance agreement. But I think that's really the only, we're obligated to support these people, the consumer. I mean, this could be a safety issue. So we have to make sure that they understand that they have some type of liability to keep that road in proper, I mean, make sure it's properly maintained.
But going back to your original question, yes, let's assume the developer does everything that even has been orally proffered here tonight and is required by the subdivision and zoning ordinances. Yeah, as we've discussed, that's when the fun frequently starts. As Mr. Shire says, these cases end up in court. They end up disputes in his office. And it would be, if permitted, I would probably redraft, quote, the road maintenance agreement really in the form of declaration of covenants to allow, to clearly vest in the owner's rights against other defaulting owners once they assume that obligation to maintain the road, and probably require, rather than be buried at settlement, that every owner, every buyer of a lot execute a copy of those declarations. Might impel them to read them.
That's good.
So,
but other than that, I think that's about all we can do.
Yeah, I have a quick question for Mr. Shire. He made a comment earlier about, since there's existing roads for the subdivision being less than seven lots or unlimited farmsteads, that they're not necessarily under the same standards they would be if there wasn't a road. My question is, since there's only half or less of a road, can whatever is in the ordinance or statute be applied in this case?
I would think that since there are standards for private roads in the zoning ordinance, the developer may not want me to say this, but the Planning Commission could make a condition of approval that they construct at least those extended portions of the road that do not exist, or fully bond the construction of them, but then the construction would have to be approved by Public Works. Lugham has no staff or engineers on board. And again, if the road bed is solid and goes all the way to the end, it may just be just simply a matter of blading up and adding more gravel and not really required construction trucks. I just don't know the extremity of the road.
Sure. One other comment. Being a licensed realtor, I mean, I deal with road maintenance agreements plenty, and somebody said that they're really only there to satisfy the lender, and that's not 99% a true statement. I've had numerous buyers contact me a year, 2 years, 5 years later and say, hey, you know, our road is, or driveway is failing, you know, what can we do? And the only thing you can do is, you know, refer them to court. Basically, we're not, you know, we're not attorneys. I don't try to be an attorney, but I agree with some of the things Mr. Siebert said about, you know, would be hard for us to impose things that's not required. I myself, since I know there's a lot of problems with road maintenance agreements, I have buyers sign just a general disclosure that I let them know that this property was under private road agreement. So at least they're not going to come back and sue me. I really think the applicant in this case will find, he said he's going to wait for the market to rebound. Well, without a decent road, he's going to wait a long time. So I think he's going to find out, or his client will find out, that investing a little bit up front is probably going to make that a whole lot more marketable in the near future versus, you know, just waiting for them exactly right 16 people to come along who have the F-350 trucks and don't care about what the road basically is. So it's a it's in a, you know, road maintenance agreements are extremely tough. I mean, we're requested to get them quite often, or try to get them, try to locate them wherever they're at. I have never had a buyer buy a property on a private road without at least asking. And then, of course, if they choose to buy it or not to buy it, I don't know at that point, as a person employed to do the best job for them, well, that's what we do. I don't really know what we as a board can do other than, I mean, you know, I agree with a note. I think full disclosure is definitely the way to go. And if somebody buys that, well, hey, they knew up front that it was like that, or that condition existed and will exist through the continuance of owning that property. But they are what they are.
There may be other options, a bad time to bring it up, but maybe the road itself could be shortened somewhat, and then the last few lots could just have their own long private driveways to that road. I mean, that would shorten the road itself and maybe lessen some of those issues. And from some point on, those end lots would just have to maintain their own private driveways.
And so, we see quite a bit of that. That's, yeah, a good point. We see quite a bit of that in subdivisions also. The last lots on the cul-de-sac have just a long single driveway.
Now, that it might not be possible because of the topo in this case, I don't know, but it's consideration.
True. Well, thank you.
Suppose, with what Mr. Van Kirk just said, suppose we were to approve this tonight and they had a road maintenance agreement, and they decided to do that, say, down the road. Because you say that the road has been about half built now, and you know that's a good, steady, sturdy base. So you decide the lots don't sell, and you decide to have individual driveways. Is that something that would have to come back before us to change, or is that something that can be just a change within house to do individual driveways if, the applicant or the seller was to decide at that point that he didn't want to bring that road all the way back and they wanted to engineer individual driveways? What would that do to this application?
I would think, unless you were adjusting lot lines or increasing number of lots, you know, in that case, it would definitely come back to you. I guess I would have to ask the Planning Commission if they would feel comfortable with that administrative.
Well, I mean, that's really not even a question tonight, but I'm just saying that, you know, say we approve it tonight and we approve it with a condition of a road maintenance agreement. And then 3 years from now, 2 years from now, when those lots aren't selling, and he's finding out because of this road maintenance agreement or the cost of the putting in the rest of this road, on building the end of it, which is going to cost considerably more than where the road is now, and they want to try individual driveways to these lots, what would that do to, I mean, what would they have to do that?
Okay, I don't think that would be an impact of a subdivision on the rest of the community, APF or anything. It's just an internal change. Okay. If it's a private road, I would say, again, it's a private road, it would be up to the property owners.
Okay.
So which may be the developer at that point, because he hasn't sold any lots. Okay. So we would work with him on that, along with Public Works.
Well, after hearing all the board members writing down, I guess the biggest thing is just the road agreement type thing. And Mr. Hunt said that he is willing to work with Mr. Sparling or go with the road agreement that he's going to try to come up with, though we know that road agreements sometimes have problems down the road. But if we have this on a plat, you know, stating and maybe we can have it, instead of number 8 font, we could move it up to number 12 font for that condition. I mean, it sounds funny, but I mean, it's just something, if they were to look down and see just something a little bit bigger, they would know that, yes, it's a road agreement. And it protects both seller and buyer at that point. The buyer can't say, well, you didn't tell me about it. I didn't read it. Like, you expect me to read all that? And the seller can say, look, I had it here in bold print that there is a road agreement. Would you, I mean, how do you feel about that, Mr. Hunt? I mean, do you think that would protect your client, you know, so that it wouldn't come back?
I think it's a very minor concession to make. I mean, I understand your intent behind that and agree with it wholeheartedly. The only thing I would ask is that you clarify what you wanted to read. I can make it big, and I can make it observable, no problem. And if I understand the intent behind it, regardless of whether or not there is any specific ordinance that governs it, I can make it visible. I understand what you're looking for.
Okay.
We'll have them make it as large as the font the newspapers use when they write about Luggum. Headline. So.
Ooh. Okay, Mr. Shop. Right, we're on RA game tonight. having heard that, is there any board members that have a suggestion on what that road, that condition may be? I mean, I'm willing to hear more than one, and we can whittle it down. And
yeah, let me lead off, and they can shoot at it, okay?
Okay.
The approvals, as is written in the motion to approve, and before the clause that says I approve the preliminary plan be approved, I'm suggesting we insert this. And further, number one, the plats shall have as a general note that the road maintenance agreement must be executed by purchasers of land within this subdivision. And number two, that the road maintenance agreement will be revised and approved by the county legal department.
Mm-hmm. Right. Do I see nods? That sound legal, Mr. Sparling? Does that sound okay? I mean, I know you're going to work with Mr. Hunt as far as the verbiage of that. But.
Yes. I was just thinking, Shire would have to answer this question. Wasn't there some standard language that appears on minor subdivision plats, or am I mistaken, about private road and not being taken over by the county?
Bob has probably seen more than I have lately.
Standard plat for a note. Standard note for a plat.
What?
I don't know that the note is required by the ordinance, but we typically have them on the plat.
What? That it's not taken over? So is the recording.
I'll work with Mr. Shire, and we'll come up with some language that is appropriate. Maybe.
Is that something we need to wait on?
Is that the?
No.
You talking about the road maintenance agreement?
Well, both that and a plat note.
And a plat note.
We'll draft a plat note that reflects the status of the road.
Okay.
Can I ask a quick question? And I don't know if it's George or Mr. Shire or Mr. Sparling, but in regards to the general notes on a plat, are they referenced by their line item number, so that if I go to, for example, I have a project, and Phil says, yeah, we'll approve it, but you got to include note 9, 10, 11, 12. And does that mean these same ones, or can they be bumped out of order? And is it that the specific note is, you're told to put a specific note on there?
Each plat is unique in their order of notes.
Okay, so us bumping this number one subject property location, that's not an issue?
Well, it's typically the first, yeah, but it's not ironclad.
What we're saying, I believe what we're saying tonight is that we want to make the road maintenance agreement number one and make it that way for a reason. I mean, look, I'm not against road maintenance agreements. Show me one that's worth the paper it's written on and I'll go for it.
And again, I was half joking, but you can put it like a headline anywhere in the plat. You can see that, so it doesn't get.
No, we're going to ask for the bigger font. Sure.
I mean, as long as it's a bigger font, I think, you know, when you look down at these general notes and you go,
well,
you know, wow,
and
but
I
if
think
you
bold
see something
type as well.
I mean, the first thing I see on this, when I see general notes, I see the word
that's
caution. To me, that stood
yes.
right out. When I looked
yes.
down there, I saw caution. So if we make it a bigger font, slightly bigger font, just even the next font, you're going to notice that's a difference wherever it may be on this list of general notes. And I think that would be, I hope that would be enough for somebody.
If you put red
ink,
it'll be, they'll know it.
Well, can we just have like the title of your road maintenance agreement in
different
bold letters too?
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Different color ink would really.
I mean, I have not given this any thought until I got here tonight, but I may not call it or may not suggest calling it a road maintenance agreement as opposed to a declaration.
Yeah.
Right.
quite frankly, probably the best order is to let us try to draft something, Mr. Shire and myself, and then craft a plat note based on it.
Right.
And
well, hearing that, Mr. Hunt, would you have a problem if this was to come back before us at the next hearing? Just so that we could see how that notes. I mean, you hear how the board is leaning. I mean, we're looking. I don't want to. You see how the board is leaning. We just have the one thing we want to make sure that is notated. That people will observe. That it, you know, we just want for that part of the protection. Would you? Is that going to hold your applicant up?
We have a buffer with the time.
Can we do all this before the next hearing so that it'll come before us?
And Mr. Shire and I can do almost anything.
God bless y'all.
Look, I got before we said that.
Okay. Does the board feel comfortable with that? So, I mean, if we were to make a motion this evening and to have it so that it would, or do we want to make that motion this evening? Do we, I mean, but we know how this is leaning.
Coming
so.
Back, do it then.
Huh?
They're coming back to it then. Don't we have to do that
yeah.
for the public?
Okay.
Continue.
And we'll just continue it, and then we'll. I mean, we basically know. I mean, everybody here is.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry. I've just been reminded the septic bill. This is grandfathered from the septic bill. It has a time of. It must have preliminary approval from the Planning Commission prior to October 1st, 2016.
Well, we can have it at the next hearing. I mean, this. I don't see any. We're all in agreement as to how this is going forth.
Second.
But this is the last meeting in August.
First meeting in September.
I would take it as a compliment if Planning Commission would trust the county attorney and myself to take care of this.
Yeah, I don't see why we can't do that.
Well, we've got. We know where y'all live and work, so I mean, we feel comfortable with that. And I know that y'all are, you know, willing to. Hey, we're all here to.
That is a compliment.
We're all make this. We're very comfortable with one another. I have no problem with what I know y'all can do. So.
I can do that. And further, number one, a plat note will be added as approved by the legal department concerning road agreements, and two, that. Something about the
just a larger font. Did we want it to? Did we want it to
number one.
With a different color?
And number two, that the note will be on the plat will be in a
larger font,
separate category from general notes and owner's certificate in a noticeable fashion.
I thought we wanted it under general notes
we
number
did.
One.
No, I think why can't it? We've got development rights notes, we got general notes, and we got the owner's certificate. And the surveyor certificate and forest indwelling board, birds, species. Why can't we add it right there? Road maintenance.
We're talking about adding it to this plan. This is not the plan that will be
Mr. Hunt, could you use the microphone?
I'm sorry.
You're talking about this plan in general, and this is not the plan that's going to be recorded. This is a large size for preliminary plan approval. We're going to have to reduce it down into half-size sheets, 18 by 24, for recordation. So this is going to look a little different when it comes time to do that. So I do think you need to specify either the general notes right underneath the general notes or at the top of the page or something like that. But don't use this as a reference. These notes will all be on there, but they may be in a different fashion.
The recordation plat, when you open it up, if I'm not mistaken, the very first thing you see is general notes, is it not? After your basic picture and such. And also on general with what Mrs. Guazzo just said, I've never observed a different color on general notes, but is it all right to ask for that?
You can ask for that, but it won't be recorded that way. They're recorded in black and white.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, as long as it's a bigger font, we can.
Yeah.
Okay. We try. But we, okay. Is everybody comfortable with that?
Mm-hmm.
All right, then I'll ask for a continuance on this, and it will come back before us on the next hearing that we have on schedule. I hope it's a light night.
I think you were asking for us to approve this tonight, right?
Yes.
I think that we should approve this
tonight.
I have
no problem with that. I heard approve the next one, but I'm...
I don't think this should be continued.
Okay.
A flat note will be approved and added, will be approved by the legal department and added to the plats, and... The note on the plats will be in a bold, easily recognizable font.
Font, correct.
Is that a motion, Ms. Guazzo? Or is that just a suggestion at this point?
Okay.
That's a skeleton of it.
That's okay, because if it is, I need you to give it to me.
All right, let me start at the beginning. In the matter of major subdivision 16-12000001, Underwood Farms, having accepted the staff report and having made a finding that the objectives of Section 30.5.5 of the subdivision ordinance for the proposed 16 lots have been met, and noting that the referenced project has met all requirements for preliminary approval and final site plan and or record plat approvals may be granted administratively upon receipt of final approvals from all agencies. And further, that a plat note will be added to the plats as approved by the legal department and the head of planning, land use, and the head of land use and growth management. And two, that this plat note will be in a bold, easily recognizable print. I move that the preliminary plan be approved.
Second.
We have a motion, and I have a second by Mr. Siebert. Is there any discussion on the motion? Okay. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. All right. Let's give a 5-minute recess so that we can get ready for the discussion.
color you want, Mr. Shire.
Okay, we'll come back in the session. Would you like a lifesaver, Mr. Shire?
Oh, no, thank you.
I didn't. That's all that counts. Okay, moving right along. Our last thing of the evening is a discussion and recommendation of the Planning Commission to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County on the sign ordinance that has been being worked on. We have had some board members that have been working with staff at their own time and leisure. I'll let them start out with this part. And Mr. I don't know who wants to start this, be it Mr. Sparling, Mr. Shire. Who would like to make the first comment? And I'd like to thank Mr. Van Kirk, Ms. Guazzo, Mr. Igniowski for giving anything that they could to this to work it along.
If it's all right with you, Mr. Chairman, I'd suggest that the individual members who met with us from time to time perhaps express their sentiments to you, since it's your recommendation you'll be making.
Since I always bang Mr. Van Kirk, this has been your night, Mr. Kaski.
I go first?
Sure.
I think, first of all, what we ought to say is that what you see in front of you, the document, that's what went to public hearing by the county commissioners. It has been annotated in red based upon the discussions we've had, and if in concurrence by the commission, planning commission tonight, that will be forwarded to the county commissioners for their consideration. That's in a nutshell. We went through, we discussed many of the items that are in here, and I think the primary one that we had was lighting. What do we do with signs that are lit, and how do we take care of them? What we originally found is different jurisdictions have done different things, but there's really, it was hard to put our finger on a federal or state standard that we could tie to. Now, I understand Shelby has found perhaps some more information that talks about on-site signs, and she may be able to go over that with us tonight. But I think that's what our general findings were. And then there's some corrections, or not corrections, but some language in here as far as distances, how far we should be from the edge of the roads before we do or do not
regulate
the signs. Thank you. And the other issue that came up, I guess, at the last meeting were monument signs at shopping centers. How do we assure that the businesses that are in there get adequately noticed by the traveling public? So I think, in a nutshell, that's kind of what we did. And I don't know if Joe's got anything to add to that.
I'm in total agreement. The ordinance, as it's before us, is fairly close to the initial ordinance that Mr. Sparling, Mr. Hunt, and Mr. Shire had initially discussed, with the changes either in red or kind of crossed out, and we've added some different caveats to it. How far non-conforming signs came up along with the illumination. What we, as Mr. Ignowski said, what we found out about illumination is everybody has an opinion. There's multiple organizations out there who have written papers, but as far as we could find, no federal or state jurisdiction had actually adopted one to say this is what the standard is. So that's what we have now, is the best recommendation from getting together and actually discussing and going over certain documents, and this is what we came up with, and I'm sure it'll be discussed further as we get into it.
So,
First of all, I hope you all got the emails from Calvert County, Jenny Welker, Plummer Welker. Is it next week that they're having a like a webinar in an auditorium or something on signs and some of the invited speakers?
I thought it was this Thursday.
Oh, this week?
Yeah.
Okay.
This Thursday.
But if you, I just want to make sure everybody got it, because it looks very interesting. I have always liked the format that Mr. Sparling and his Mr. Hunt and Mr. Shire and who did I leave out? Mr. Bill Weisskopf. Is it Bill? Dave Weisskopf. As they said, they meet on Wednesdays, and we were privileged to join them three times for this. I think they spent, we spent six or, y'all, I couldn't come to the last meeting, but 6 or 7 hours was devoted to this. And I am in agreement with the Red's marks that are on here. I think they've done a great job. That, as Mr. Sparling said, we stuck to the issues that were brought up in the public hearing, which were illumination, bus shelters, billboards, two-sided signs, flashing signs, and, whoops, something about, I can't even read my own writing. Research the digital signs not to be a traffic distraction and look into that side of it. We agreed pretty much that bus shelters should go the way of the dodo bird, and in their present iteration, and that we should require them from now on to be visible from three sides, the open road and two sides. That I think it's a safety issue. You would never catch me leaving my daughter in one of those things. They're dark, they're dank, they're dirty, and they're just clearly there for to hold up a sign, not as a efficient, safe shelter. So the consensus was to recommend that, I don't know where you're going to stick them in an ordinance, but that they not be part of the sign ordinance anymore, and that they we recommended that they be made transparent or translucent, so they could be easily seen in, as well as provide protection from the elements. And I think that's probably what Commissioner Jarbo meant when he said we can't get rid of the bus shelters. I'm thinking he would be happy to separate the signs from the bus shelter, but keep the bus shelters. The only thing that I continue to have a hang up with is illumination. The lady from Calvert County recommend the International Sign Association research paper on illumination, and I would, and this is particularly in regard to the electronic signs. The paper only has to do with on-premise signs, not off-premise signs, which I don't proposed to have anything to do with. This ordinance, this draft ordinance, eliminates any off-premise signs that the county would have control of. It says that whatever official signs by the feds or the state or the county are the law of the land, if they're off-premise signs along highways and roadways. And they have also written in to include that the sign, particularly the signs that point to historic structures or historic sites, and that's fine. So I am recommending this 14-page article. It briefly, it has examples of here, of around the county, around the nation, that have been adopted. And the and they recommend that foot candles be used to measure luminance. You measure the ambient light versus the light given from the sign, and they recommend as a standard that's been adopted in many places that they not exceed 0.3 foot candles over ambient lighting conditions when recommended at the recommended distance based on the electronic message see me, EMC, which is code for electronic message board, and they have a chart in here on how to do that. They recommend using the Lux meter. It's $100, according to the article. It measures light impact and appearance, works with roadway lighting standards. It's easy to check and enforce. And this article goes on to give case studies in Columbus, Ohio, Kitsap County, Washington, and Sparks, Nevada. And it does include also a technology. They recommend that dimming after certain times in the evening, and that the dimming is the technology is available now within this to be added to the sign, so that it a photo cell or a scheduled dimming at a certain time to dim the light, not turn it off, but just dim it from it's the traveling public. So perhaps the trucker going down the road at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, it won't be as bright for him as the usual customary traveling public. And there's more in here, but I think we need a very broadly written electronic message definition, and we need to set a standard for the illumination factor and some way to set a standard for it that is easily checked up on and enforceable. Other than that, the draft document is fine.
Mr. Shar, didn't you say once before that your department does have Lux meters?
We have light meters. They're pretty old and subject to, I won't say inaccuracies. I
maybe
difficult to use.
If Chairman would, Mr. Hunt did considerable amount of research into this issue of luminosity or illumination, but he was also very concerned with enforcement. I don't know whether he had the benefit of this article or not, but there's stress on the ability to enforce it, because there's, I think we're all in agreement, that it doesn't serve a useful purpose to write a provision that can't be practically enforced. I don't know whether you want to hear from Mr. Hunt on this.
Always like to hear from Mr. Hunt on anything he'd like to talk to us about. I'm not asking about it as far as a strict enforcement tool. I've even noticed that since we had our previous talk here, a couple of the signs that Mr. Willard and I were talking about have amazingly gone down in brightness, you know. So sometimes it's just either word of mouth or just, you know, if somebody was to complain to Luggum about a certain thing and just some, you know, they might not be aware that it's that bright. You know, I don't think they do it. I don't think any business would say, you know, I'm going to shock them into reading this sign. I think that would be, you know, to their detriment. I'm not saying that, but.
Well, one overriding philosophy that I discussed with the individual members who from time to time attended was that after weeks of meetings before the Planning Commission became involved, we realized that trying to deal with every possible scenario became a bit of a fool's errand. There was some thought that maybe see what happens, and if there are complaints, then adapt or amend the ordinance as necessary to address the complaints. I'm not disagreeing with Mrs. Guazzo, and again, I have no position on brightness or luminosity or foot candles or what's the other thing, lumens, I guess? Nits. That's correct, nits. My principal concern, since ultimately would fall on my office, is the enforceability and how to deal with it.
And as you said, as this moves along, it's going to be, I mean, this new type of advertisement is going to be a learning curve for everybody involved. So, I mean, it's something that, you know, the enforcement of it is as you said, it would be tough. But as we learn, you know, we bend and we move in those directions.
I forgot to say that on page 8 is the recommended legislative language written out and the standards for how you read the sign, the signs that you had a complaint about that need to be read. And so I read it through. It's very simple. There's 4 items. It has to do with nighttime illumination at a set forth below. A is the illumination measurement criteria. B is the illumination limits. C is dimming capabilities. And D is the definition of an electronic message sign. And then there's the chart on, depending on the size of the sign, the distance you stand away to read it. So, and the 3 case studies are interesting. They're recent, and there's a whole lot of stuff on that website. This was the one I read. I mean, they also have the studies. And this is not old. This was just released 3 weeks ago that they finished it. So it's
Planning Commission desires to make that part of their recommendation. That's the prerogative of the Planning Commission.
I will have to say that as everyone who attended these meetings know, from the first meeting, second meeting, and third meeting that we had, the main topic was illumination. Ms. Quazio wasn't there for the last meeting, but as you can imagine, it's been the main topic. Mr. Ignowski found many articles on illumination. Mr. Hunt sent us articles, had articles. I found some. What our determination came to, and I say as a consensus, was that if the state hadn't adopted any particular one of these papers, then how could we? I mean, a jurisdiction can. It actually says you can adopt something, but if there's no way to enforce it, and we checked with Mr. Shire, Mr. Hunt, there had been no abundance of complaints about any illuminated sign. Also, the question came up about in enforcement. Somebody calls and says there's a sign that's bright when they're driving in the road 10 o'clock at night. Who's going out there? Is the meter calibrated? So we kind of came to the consensus that it was in the best interest for illumination to kind of see what happened, since there wasn't really. I mean, there are a couple signs that people had noted that seemed a little excessively bright at night. But as a whole, one of the articles that we found actually stated from the Federal Highway Administration in 98, they did a study in 2009, 98% of the signs, illuminated signs at that time, that's 2009, technology is different now, were under 150 nits. And the article that I had recommended things to be under like 125 nits, which is not necessarily exceedingly bright. So I don't know what the board wants to do, but we spent a lot of time talking about illumination with a lack of complaints, lack of documented accidents from the shock of brightness of signs. I didn't really know what we could. That's why I was kind of determined to see what happened with illumination.
I think one of the things that the staff has indicated is that this is going to be somewhat of a growing document, I guess is probably a better word, is that as we go through and we see problems that occur, this would then be revised or with new technology. As things change, we would be able to modify this easily in order to adjust for that. And I think we've got to keep that in mind, too.
Yeah, Mr. Sparling, can I ask, what's the big issue with the enforcement?
Mr. Hunt, can I ask Mr. Hunt to...
Okay, I'm sorry.
I haven't got the foggiest idea how you check.
I mean, it sounds outwardly what Ms. Guazzo's got. It sounds simple enough to test it. But what do you do once I put a meter on you and say, okay, Mr. Sign Owner, your sign's too bright. Now what do we do? What's the problem there?
That's part of the problem right there. It's an allegation. If we were to, inspection division, were to receive a complaint of a sign that is allegedly too bright, assuming that there are some kind of objective standard that would be included in this ordinance, which would have to go beyond, I believe, just the 0.3-foot candles measured from what, minus the ambient light, with a properly calibrated instrument that could be demonstrated in court, the inspector would use it, presumably, and based on his ability to make that measurement, give a citation to the owner, which is an allegation, just like a speeding ticket or anything else. You have your day in court. What is going to be the basis of the county going forward and getting some kind of sanction against the owner that the owner can't refute easily in court?
And the the other thing is that the two bases for regulating signs are aesthetics and public safety. It was impressed upon me by one of my colleagues from Baltimore City, actually, that before you even get to the public safety issue, the exercise of police power, as we call it, in the interest of aesthetics, can become a very slippery slope, because as soon as you get to aesthetics, you get to matters of a judgment. Mm-hmm. One person as opposed to another person. When we get to court, in addition to all the technical problems, but years ago I prosecuted speeding tickets, so I know about calibrating a speed detection device. I guess I could do the same with light. But there just didn't seem to be any generally accepted standard. I mean, there's this recommendation here. Both gentlemen did quite a bit of research, and Mr. Hunt did a bit of research. And my concern would be that if we go with 125 nits or whatever, 0.35 candle, are we just picking numbers out of the air?
Right.
As opposed to...
Is there an accepted number that the basic country is using?
Right. And that's what we were unable. Matter of fact, I don't want to speak to the gentleman beyond the dais, but I think we're a little bit surprised to find there wasn't. That's why we were. Mrs. Guazzo's points are extremely well taken. I guess it just when we realized that there was no generally accepted standard, we were a little bit reluctant to wade into the water. The other problem is, from the enforcement point of view, I don't know how we necessarily, I haven't read the article, and I'm not sure I'd understand the article if I read it as far as a light meter, but we have a legal issue about how do we get to the sign to measure the light.
Right.
I mean, what happens when Mr. Hunt's inspector goes down there and says to the owner, we've got a complaint that your sign's too bright, and the owner says, well, can't please everybody, now get off my property. I don't know how close you have to be to this sign to measure it and exclude ambient light, but there are those issues as well. And again, instead of trying to jump in front of those issues, we just thought we'd see, or there was a thought that perhaps wait and see how things pan out.
So we're kind of waiting on to see what the sort of move the state's going to make in order to let it trickle down to us to give us some guidance into what we want to do legally.
Well, and again, that was part of our thought. We went and looked and thought, well, this ought to be pretty easy. Let's adopt whatever standards the state has. But that didn't turn out to be that simple either. So, and again, I'm not trying to argue contrary to Mrs. Guazzo's opinion. I'm just trying to indicate some of the difficulties with this particular topic.
Well, with that being a research document and such, of course, there's always, as with anything, there's going to be another research group that's going to say, that was not quite what we think it is type of thing. So we would need to find a happy medium. I mean, as these sorts of studies, which now with the signs coming out the way they are, everything's electronic now. I mean, we're going to see a day here soon where there's not going to be that poor man that used to paint that nice sign. Donnie Poe's not going to get to paint a pretty sign anymore. It's going to be electronic with a pretty picture on it instead. As that change comes, in time we'll get more guidance on this, I guess is what I'm hearing.
Oh, we may.
That's fine. This is a research document put out by the International Sign Association, and has been used by other people. You do need something rather than just laissez-faire. It's, I don't think the answer is waiting for the state to do something. Usually it's the local people that promote enough thought and agitation to a subject that the state wakes up and says, yeah, maybe we ought to do something about this. It doesn't usually happen from the top down with any great success.
Well, it's still going to go back to the two issues that Mr. Sparling mentioned. If the county were to adopt whatever the recommendation of that study is that really going to be something that is tied in with either aesthetics or a hazard? Or is it just arbitrary, the best that they came up with, something in the middle that pleases most people? When it comes to enforcement, once again, is it going to be a situation of one nit over that means you're in violation? It's going to still be an enforceable problem that I don't see any way that we can come to grips with in a way that's going to be satisfactory. If it's going to be nighttime illumination that's going to be the problem, which means the inspector or inspectors or me or Phil, whoever happens to be handy, is going to be called on to make these readings at night and then follow through with the prosecution of, that's a harsh word, but whatever word you prefer, to make sure that the allegation gets sent forward and gets acted upon, as opposed to the owner just saying, well, I've dialed it down now, I'm at 149, or I disagree with your reading, my meter said such and such. No matter what standard you have, if it's not a safety hazard, which we do cover in the ordinance, or if it's not related to aesthetics, which is not going to be easy to do, it's still a standard that's going to be unenforceable based on what we have to deal with in St. Mary's County.
I don't think you write legislation for the one person who's going to violate it. I think you write it as a set of standards that 90 something percent of the population will welcome the standard and try and follow it. And I
would only, and again, not to argue the point, because I have no position on this other than the practical aspects, but you do write an ordinance for the one person that's not going to go along with it, because it's a prohibition. And the one philosophy I've tried to express throughout this entire process is whatever the county writes, please make sure the county has the ability and the will to enforce it. And that it's not going to be a matter of benign neglect or somebody asking for an exception simply because they want an exception. These are going to be the rules, and they're going to be enforced.
I got a question. How does John Q. Citizen know who to contact to complain about one of these things?
Oh, he knows. He knows.
Well, if I hadn't been here, I wouldn't have any idea who to call about.
Word gets around. I mean, they call Ludham.
And how many people do they call before they get to the right person?
I would have no idea
to call Mr. Hunt and tell him about something like that. I learned that tonight.
Well, we're going to publish his home cell phone number.
But there are people that if you start talking about something in a group, you'll find that there are other people who object to the same thing that you object to, but they've never voiced their opinion to any governmental agency that has jurisdiction over that subject.
I've found over the years that people will call the commissioner of their particular area, their district. They definitely know who to call. And the commissioners also know who to call. So,
can I ask real quick, is there even a standard that they follow for signs? Because I know with lighting, I'm no light engineer by no means, but I do know from some of my involvement with some lighting things that there's candle power, candelas, lumens, lux, watts. And now nits. I'm hearing nits. I mean, there's a sixth one. Which one of the six is there even one of them that's recognized as the way to properly measure a sign?
For the digital ones, the most common that I've run into is a reference to nits, which then in a formula does break down into these other things. Did you find that too, Mr. Van Kirk, or did you get something?
Yes, all the things that you mentioned, Mr. Siebert, are kind of the same thing. It's just in a different language. You know, a lumen is going to translate, you know, 0.3 lumens is going to translate to so many nits. Mm-hmm. Or it's just, you know, I don't know if it was different types of bulbs. You know, they used to have fluorescent bulbs and LEDs and all kind of different.
It seems like just because there's six ways to measure it, that means there's five ways to challenge the enforcement issue, right, Mr. Sparling? I mean, is that reasonable?
We probably would have to introduce, well, we'd have to make sure that the local inspectors were using one of the six measures, and that's the one that's provided for in the ordinance, because we wouldn't be in the position to bring in a physicist or electrical engineer, I don't know, into court to give an explanation of the equivalencies of these different units.
As I understand it, they don't all equate to, they don't all have an equivalent, because you mentioned lux. That's what they're using?
It's discussed foot candles versus nits, and what are the pros and cons of each one in the article.
Because I know lux is light's ability to flood an area with a certain amount of light, where isn't candle power, is like how bright you, how far away you can see it in terms of brightness and still see the thing. So they don't all, maybe they do, but I don't think they all even correlate exactly to one another. I mean, maybe the other one, some of them do, but I know Lux is a little different. So.
Yeah, I may not be the same. They're all, in the end, going to give you a brightness.
Right.
However you call it. I mean, if you measure a sign with a Lux meter, it's going to give you, you know, I mean, I don't really know what the differences are. If you put 10 lights or 6 lights there and measure them with the 6 different meters, if they were all the same brightness, you're going to get, you know, 100 nits, 3 candle power, 25 Lux. Generally, I think it's kind of going to translate to close to the same brightness. I just don't know the total difference, and neither did anybody else when
these
we
measures
researched.
I'd like to repeat, this is the International Sign Association doing their research to monitor themselves. This is not some giant anti-group. These are writing reasonable standards to modify their own industry to standards. So there's a good discussion, nits versus foot candles. They have 8 points for each one, pros and cons. Nits is very difficult. It measures only amount of brightness. The meter costs $1,000. It does not allow for the adjustment based on the ambient light. Does not measure, it's difficult, says right here, difficult to measure accurately and difficult to enforce. That's the NHTSA one. So it's a well thought out article by, you know, the people that are monitoring themselves.
That goes along with what Mr. Sparling mentioned earlier, that we are in hopes if we adopt it, when we adopt it, this will be self-policing. That sign in Gray Mills that everybody complained about, maybe they read about it in the paper, and that's why the illumination was turned down on it. So it's self-policing. They don't want to drive people away and irritate the customer. So
that's I figured they watched Channel 95 and
well, for those people,
complain.
Or stop by Dyson's and saw you, Mr. Lee.
You're better off watching a digital sign.
And for those people who do watch Channel 95, Mr. Hung alluded to it, I think. But the ordinance does, in more general terms, state that signs or lights are prohibited which A, may be construed as a traffic or street sign or signal, B, may impede the ability to observe any traffic or street sign or signal, C, is or creates a device that moves or swings as a result of wind pressure, or D, creates a hazardous condition for a motorist, pedestrian, or the general public. So without getting into the specifics of how many nits or how many whatever's the other five, we have attempted to address the public safety issue on a generalized rather than a formulistic approach.
You must have read my mind, because that's what I was going to ask you. So we keep talking about that one certain sign. Say somebody was bothered by it, you know, without having to go out there with a meter of some sort, your department would be able to just inquire, you know, to say that you had inquiries on such signs and have had, you know, a complaint or two. Most of the time, that takes care of that problem. In this case, I'd like to say we don't know exactly what happened. I don't know if it came through your department or what. But the two signs that we have been complaining about, the ones that I see, because I have the great luck of coming down to 235 at 5 o'clock in the morning, and go through Great Mills and all that stuff, so I got to see all these wonderful signs. All of a sudden, they have dimmed. I mean, they have, whether they watched this or whatever, they heard something, because all of a sudden they have dimmed. So I guess just by phone calls, be it word of mouth or whatever, if it comes to your department or whatever, generally, I mean, any business, I'm sure, wouldn't want complaints. I mean, in this day and age where you can get on the internet and go to certain news agencies and such and say, you know, there's a problem, it's not being taken care of, they seem to want to get way ahead of that before it comes and bites them. So
public pressure is a good force.
It works. So okay. Anybody else? Guy?
It sounds like the big question is: do we head a problem off at the pass, or wait and see if there's a problem to begin with? On the one hand, it's always good to head them off at the pass if you really have to. On the other hand, if we do have something, and it's probably easier to enforce what we've got now, sounds like anyway, than if we put a bunch of formulas and specs in. I don't know.
How can you enforce it if you don't have any standards? I mean, just to say it's public safety, it's like, prove it. Where does it say this in the ordinance? What standards do you use
to make this?
So it's a double-edged sword.
I agree. But you're going to get somebody to challenge it either way. You can always get somebody to challenge it.
Well, I wanted to bring it out in the open as an issue, and we're on television, and so we're having this discussion.
Don't get me wrong. I believe one day, I don't know if it's today is the right time, but I believe one day we certainly will. You'll see all the jurisdictions have a light inspector with a meter.
Next time you drive through Anne Arundel County at night, there are many electronic billboards, the great big jobs high up in the sky, mm-hmm. and they'll come down here. There's mm-hmm. no regulation, no prohibition. We're not doing billboards, of course, but Anne Arundel County is way ahead on that scene. I only saw one in Virginia on my way to a meeting in Virginia last week. But
they don't show up
in the daytime. They do show up at night, really.
Well, there's a terrible sign if you cross the bridge in Virginia and you take the shortcut over to Route 3 from 301. There's a little, about halfway across that road, it's about a 9-mile road. I can't remember the name of the road, but it's on the left if you're heading toward Fredericksburg. And there's a little place there that they work on cars and trucks, and they sell tires and mufflers and stuff. And they've got a sign there that, I think it is 206. Yeah. It will blow your eyeballs out. I don't know that I would call it a safety hazard. Maybe to some people, I guess it could be. My vision's pretty good, but it certainly is an annoyance. I mean, if I ever stopped in there, I'd probably say, God, can you turn that thing down? But for us to call someone and say, hey, I don't think it needs to get to that point. I mean, not by me, it doesn't, but I don't know.
I wish the research paper that you had gotten had just had not told us. I wish there had been a better way for the NITS, I guess you call it. They're telling us how hard it's going to be to measure mm-hmm. and to do that. That's tough. I mean, that's not giving us a...
No, they gave them the other one, the Lux.
Yeah, the Lux.
With the Lux with a $100 meter instead of a $1,000 meter. And it does, the Lux does the ambient light. I think, like I said, you need some kind of standard to put in there to...
I'd just like to ask a question,
whatever.
If I can, so, be prepared.
No, it's okay.
Is there a sign, you don't have to identify it by location or owner, but is there a sign in St. Mary's County today that is you would consider a hazard to public safety?
I haven't seen one.
Not now. I did.
So just trying to keep it in perspective. So then what we get down to is not the public safety issue, which we've attempted to cover, but the aesthetics. Again, a sign may indeed be annoying, but what's annoying to one person may or may not be annoying to another person. I just point this out.
Well, this says in here it creates a hazardous condition for motorists. I mean, there's avenues that, you know, we can call, you know, to do that. as you said, we're not going to be able to do anything about the aesthetics because it's changing too quick. I mean, it's 30 years driving to Piney Point, I've seen signs change a lot. You know, I mean, it's a whole different world. So it's going to change. Even where I'm at in Piney Point, there's electronic signs now that don't, you know, put out, they put out a nice bit of information, changeable type of information that's good for the public, and it doesn't create a hazard or anything like that. So, I mean, it's a good thing to have. It's easier to change, and in this day and age, things change so quickly and so much that they have to be able to keep on top of things.
I just want to add one more thing. I don't think we disagree with Ms. Guazzo. It was, as Mr. Ignowski will say, it was our main focal point at every meeting to talk about illumination. We left every meeting saying, well, we're going to go back and find some more documentation and come back and discuss it at the next meeting, which we did. And then by the time we got to that third meeting, I think it was Mr. Sparling that said, well, are you ready to tell Mr. Hunt that he was right? And we were like, yes. It was, I mean, as to put it as simple as that, because we found plenty of articles, plenty of documents from different sign companies. I got one from the International Association of Lighting Standards or something, and every one of them says something different. So with the lack of what to put in there, I mean, you can put any number in there. I mean, but what's the actual right number to put in there, and with no guidance from any federal or state jurisdiction saying that this is, through all our research, this is what we have come up with by cross-referencing all these papers. We didn't know what to put in there. So we asked Mr. Shire and Mr. Hunt, had there been major complaints from any particular signs? And they said, no. So with that lack of data and the consensus of we didn't know what to put in there, it seemed logical just to create the document and have it for if it needs to be altered or amended in the future when the signs become brighter. If they become a hazard, then I think it could be addressed. I mean, I know of a couple signs that's fairly bright. I don't really know what the definition. I think somebody said everybody's definition of what's hazardous is totally different. I mean, if it's blocking a stop sign or a red light, of course, that would be something that's hazardous. But the illumination was the most difficult decision or discussion that we had through all three of the meetings.
Let me ask this, Mr. Sparling. How fast can we amend this document?
How fast?
If we let this document go the way it is, without the numbers and the meters and the enforcement, and at such time in the future it proves that we need that, or we feel like we need that, is it a matter of days, weeks, months, a year? I mean, what is it? Do we have to wait 3 years for a certain time, like call a special meeting, do it that day?
I mean, approximately 5 weeks.
5 weeks, okay.
Under our current form of government.
Okay.
That's if we get, if we have problems that we need to fix, that's what you're referring to.
So, but all the ones that were created before you sign off on some new thing, new standard in 5 weeks, is grandfathered?
No, I'm sorry, I'm not being clear.
You're talking about an amendment that would, for instance, incorporate the standards that Mrs. Guazzo has brought to our attention, or yes, something similar to that.
Something similar.
Approximately.
Even easier.
Approximately 5 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah, suppose the Acme Light Company comes up with a new meter that we can do this by standing out on the road. You don't have to go on the property.
And the Acme Sign Company comes up with a bunch of new signs that are real bright and real cheap, and they pop up everywhere.
No, I'm talking about the Acme sign, or the Acme meter company comes up with a new thing that says, you know, they don't even have to go on the site. They can be in a vehicle and point it at a sign. You know, so then, yes, we can measure that in a reasonable way and an accurate way, you know, to do it.
And I'd be concerned about, as Mr. Siebert says, Acme Sign Company coming out with new and different signs, and that's a little bit of the problem of, you know, trying to hold jello. The technology changes so quickly.
Well, I'm looking at it more as a measurement tool. Yeah. I guess I used the wrong wording on that. Not a sign company, but a lumen measuring company.
Well,
if they were to come out with a new instrument that can accurately do that.
That would take care of one end of it. And quite frankly, if I had to make a prediction, yes, I think the day will come, and I don't know whether it's going to be this year, next year, or the year after, or whenever, when the county will, if they don't do anything now in terms of specific objective standards, I'll call them, we'll have to revisit that because, again, I'm out of my field when it comes to physics, but and I think I had a high school teacher who will attest to that, but the multiplicity of signs, there are going to be more and more and more of them, and it may be the cumulative effect that ultimately creates a problem apart from maybe any one individual sign. I don't know.
A couple of things. Many, 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 many years ago, probably after the First World War, the United States started to rebuild roads. Every state accepted or developed their own standards. I want my road to be like this. I want my road to be like this. There was no national standard for what should govern road construction for the entire country. And I think we're seeing the same thing here. There are standards for light measurement, what's good, what's bad, what's indifferent. There is no national standard yet that I think we can hang our hat on. And I think until that happens, or we get close to that, where there's a standard that's uniformly accepted, I think we wait and see. Number one. Number two, I think we've accomplished, with your agreement, on the red marks and what's in here in red, it sounds like it is, I think we've accomplished what we've been asked to do, is to review the ordinance by the county commissioners that went to public hearing and come up with suggestions. I think we've done that. And I think we ought to perhaps send this to them with that recommendation, with also a caveat and a recommendation that something will have to be done about sign brightness for safety and for aesthetics. And when those standards come up, the county ought to consider adopting them. And that's where I think we are. I mean, I think we've done what the commissioners have asked us to do.
Mm-hmm. You have, and I commend them.
Again, if this
board,
is accepted.
But the three board members that worked with the staff for doing so.
Did, in your covering letter, you said something about the bus shelters. You covered that. There was consensus to change the architecture of bus shelters.
In the email when I forwarded this to the...
Yeah. Will you put that also? Will you forward it to the county commissioners? Because it's not addressed in here, and I wanted them to know that we had considered the idea and come to that consensus that you, the way you wrote it up.
And since this matter is now on the commissioner's agenda again, I might suggest that the Planning Commission authorize the chairman to deliver a letter to the county commissioners indicating what the recommendations and position of the board, including perhaps Mr. Ignowski's language. I'll be glad to work with the chairman, but I think it should come from the board, not from me.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, this.
And I'm willing to make that motion that the chairman be authorized to sign a letter concurring with what's here, again, if you all agree with that, to the county commissioners, and make note that there is another issue that is still out there that will need to be addressed, which is the lighting of signs or emitting of light from signs.
And perhaps Mrs. Guazzo's reference to bus shelters.
And also that, I guess I'm doing a motion, aren't I? And also that bus shelters be clear on three sides, and period.
is that we recommend a change in the architecture to, for right. safety for bus shelters, that they be...
I'll accept that.
...clear, visible, to see through them on three sides.
I've got one item that I think needs to be changed in 02-04, event signs. Is a sign that includes only notice of a single lawful event, including the time, date, place of the event, or the direction to the location of the event. I think we should delete the word time.
Well, before we can do that, I did have a motion, if I'm not mistaken. Mr. Spaulding, keep me straight on this because I want to make sure I'm doing this right. I had a motion already made. Now, it wasn't seconded. I've had Mr. Willard would like to amend that. If Mr. Igniewski were to ask that his motion...
I'm going to make your job simple.
That's what you're here for, Mr. Spaulding. That's what you make that money.
This is the result. Mr. Willard and I had a discussion before it started, and He kind of interesting because I always wondered in a practical matter, is this going to be a fully understandable ordinance? And Mr. Willard gave me the equivalent of flashcards. He had about half a dozen or more pictures of various objects and places, and asked me one right after the other, will this be legal? Will this be illegal? And I think Mr. Willard was a little bit surprised that I was actually able to respond pretty immediately as to which were or were not. That was a long preface to, Mr. Willard, I'm going to make that change.
Okay.
To clarify that. So.
Okay. Then, Mr. Igniewski,
it's a technical change.
Holds up. Holds true.
I just have one quick, I'm unclear on something. Maybe that's a bad way to say it, but people not very often accidentally walk through a brick wall, but they sometimes walk through plate glass windows. So how does making something clear make it more visible?
Well, in the city, you'll notice that there are bus shelters that are basically opaque. They're transparent on three sides, but you can clearly see the three sides and the posts that support them and the roof structure.
It's a coming thing, really. They just
it's for protection. I mean,
for safety.
So when you say transparent, you don't mean like crystal clear glass.
Translucent. How about that word? You can see light, lucent through them.
There are bus standard designs. Probably in our MPO searches, and the county erects bus shelters for the STS system and so on, and I bet good money that there are adopted standards for bus shelters, and I don't know why they wouldn't apply it to school bus shelters as well.
I would think so.
Clearly, what we have now is just something to screw a sign into. It's really not designed.
Now, the existing shelters with sign, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if they have obtained the permits and gone through the process, they would be considered non-conforming, and then...
Until they change the sign,
yeah, so they would,
the advertising.
Sure.
They would not be able to change the advertising.
But they would be, what, 2 years? Is that the non-conforming signs can stick around for 2 years?
That's the recommendation.
That's
recommendation.
What I read? Okay. I think translucent is the word I should have used, not transparent. Translucent
like
means
you
can see the light.
What's that? I'm sorry?
Not like a clear piece of glass. They're tinted.
Actually, my recollection is they're usually a little bit smoky colored. The
smoky
grayish tint to them or something.
Okay.
Like
I have a motion from Mr. Igniewski.
Second.
I have a second from Ms. Guaza. Is there any more discussion?
I got a question about the construction material on these bus shelters. We had bus shelters for our grandchildren when when they were there. That bus shelter was bought and paid for by the people that had their signs on the sides of the shelter. The school system didn't buy them. We didn't buy them. The organization that wanted their sign out near the highway provided that shelter. They even provided a cement slab that they put the thing on. And when we didn't need it anymore, we called them and they came and took it away. Translucent, transparent. It was made out of, I don't think, it might have been aluminum. But it was formed in a factory someplace, and their name was put on it. I think it was Birch Oil. Was on there on two sides of it.
Well, they changed.
Fine for
you buy space on it.
Huh?
They you buy space on those signs.
They bought that whole thing. It belonged to them. And when we didn't need it anymore, they came and got it, took up the slab and moved it someplace where they needed it.
I think what we're talking about is eliminating them to get that off of the public roads, the advertising on those signs.
You'd still be able to have bus shelters, I'm sure, but
yeah,
you're
right.
Not going to see it.
I think that's what we're saying, is you can have both bus shelters. Yeah. That's not the issue. It's just the signs on them.
Who's going to pay for them?
I have two of them in our area that residents have put up for their own neighborhood kids. They got together and they put it up.
And if the school
vision we looked at earlier, I mean, the 16, whatever it is, 14 residents in there may want to put one up, and they would join together and fund that and put it up, or call the county and ask them to put it up for them, and here's the money. I think that's what we were talking about.
But right now they are primarily signs first, bus shelters second.
Right.
You wouldn't see but a fraction of them if they didn't have advertising on them.
Okay.
Okay.
Kids would stand in the rain.
Well,
or the
they
snow.
They have parents to help them make good decisions.
We have several improvements on the road that I live on, and I've lived there 16 years. I have yet to see the first kid stand in any of them. I mean, I don't know. It's just like the road, the private road. I paved my own road because I want to drive on asphalt. I didn't wait for the asphalt ferry. And if
you
my
don't
kids
have
needed
a Ford F-350.
No, I don't. And if my kids needed shelter, I'd build that too. I mean, I wouldn't wait for the bus shelter ferry. I mean,
A lot of parents don't let their children sit at the end of the roads by themselves anymore.
They don't. Yeah. They're driving down there in the car.
That's why we're basically going to the translucent type of bus shelter, if we have them, in order for the safety of the children, because I can just say from experience, there's a bus shelter at the end of my grandchildren's road, but they don't use it because there's always somebody that really shouldn't be in that bus shelter, it's time for them to get either on or off the bus, even after complaining to the sheriff's department, which there really wasn't anything they could do about it because that shelter was there, it's on public property, and that person wasn't doing anything wrong. But did they feel comfortable having the children sitting there? No. So
they were all on private property, really?
Well, I mean, this one's right on the road, so
right,
I mean,
away?
It's got to be on that right away, so I'm not even going to delve into that. Anyway. All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mr. Sparling, you earned your keep this evening. Thank you, sir. And thank all the members of the board for this, the ones that went to the meetings. Appreciate your time that you spent on it. A lot came out of it.
Do we get a bonus in our paycheck?
Yes, sir. You look. Wait for it. Check's in the mail, and I thank everybody. If there's no other business for the evening,
motion to adjourn.
I have a motion to adjourn. The second, all in favor.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.